So far, we have covered several topics on how the United States, China, and some European Union countries are handling the economic collapse that resulted from the financial and global health crisis. But today, other emerging economies are going to receive some attention, and we're going to discuss their economic situations at the present moment and how their futures will be affected. According to a global survey carried out by the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, UNCTAD, the speed in which the current economic crash wave reached developing countries is worryingly dramatic, even if we compare the global financial crisis of 2008. One of the highlighted points inside this report is that times of crisis often lead to capital flights from emerging markets, as investors seek assets for refuge and tend to buy U.S. treasuries, used as a safe alternative to preserve capital. But as we discussed in previous videos, this security is likely to be considerably reduced soon. Now, here is a quick important message. You may have heard that YouTube revenues have dropped about 50% during these hard and turbulent months. Now, we would ask your help in these hard times. Here at Epic Economist, we are paying for script writing, voiceover, video editing, video footage, and thumbnails. They cost thousands of dollars each month. With your help, however, we can continue to publish fresh economic collapse news daily. Don't think, "Oh, why should I help? Others will solve this." Look, if everyone thinks this, nothing will happen, will it? Don't believe that your $1 will not help. It will. If everyone helps, it'll work. So look, please click the link below, pick up your card, sign up for Patreon to support Epic Economist. It's only $1 a month. That's all. One little dollar for a full month. It only takes a minute for you to sign up, but it helps to keep alive this great community through these extremely difficult times and beyond. We thank you very much. The website is www.patreon.com/epiceconomist. Thank you. Between February and March alone, $59 billion had been removed from these emerging markets. And this is more than double the exits experienced by the same countries in the immediate aftermath of 2008's global financial crisis. At that time, there was a $26.7 billion flight. And we well know that we are only at the beginning of this crisis. Moreover, the local effects of the virus and the prices of certain commodities were also unfavorable to many of these countries. This seems to be only the beginning of the storm, as emerging economies have fewer opportunities for fiscal and monetary maneuvers. Besides the global aspects, there are regional specific factors for each country. Despite being the original epicenter of the health crisis, China remained almost untouched, according to recent analysis. Countries in Eastern and Southern Asia, except from Indonesia and the Philippines, appear to have been only slightly affected. Now, this may reflect both the incomplete integration of its financial markets and the market's perception of its relatively strong macroeconomic funds. Eastern Europe, Hungary, Poland, and Romania were also barely affected. On the other hand, commodity producers were heavily affected by price drops, similar to what happened in 2008-2009. The collapse of the OPEC Plus cartel in early March 2020 further reduced the already decreasing price of oil. This has been reflected in the performance of the main market indicators, mainly the sovereign debt, foreign exchange rates, and equities, indicating that a deep deterioration is happening in several other emerging countries that estimate reduced growth expectations, such as Mexico, Russia, Nigeria, Colombia, Brazil, and Indonesia. Finally, countries that have already had problems with macroeconomic and financial stability, for example, Argentina, Costa Rica, Nigeria, Pakistan, Turkey, and Ukraine, have been more affected than others. In addition to this, it's important to remember that the health crisis will be followed by a shortage of goods and food and social unrest. But even before the disease hit these countries directly, they had already been negatively affected by the economic impact of the crash in China and other parts of the developed world. Most emerging countries have very poor health systems, not enough beds and hospital breathers, crowded cities and slums, large numbers of workers who receive daily wages or work informally and aren't able to work remotely. So we can forecast that for many emerging countries, this health crisis will quickly become a tragic humanitarian crisis and ultimately a solvency crisis. Political stability will only be the cherry on top of the cake. After considering all these factors, you may be asking yourself, how will the global economic collapse affect the economy of these countries? Are we moving towards a global recession? And what could be done to try and reduce the impacts of the economic collapse on emerging economies? And we're going to try and give you some answers in this video. According to the data released by UNCTAD, the world will suffer a $2 trillion blow, with an impact of more than $220 billion on emerging countries, if the outbreak isn't stopped over the course of the next few months. The effects of the past major contagious disease crisis on the economy have already been analyzed in several economic studies. The World Bank estimates that the cost of a severe flu outburst, for example, could reach 5% of global GDP. As it was stated by a report from Marsh, although outbreaks such as those we are experiencing today have lower mortality rates than those from the past due to advances in medicine and infrastructure in developed and emerging countries, the potential for economic impacts may be much bigger. This happens because the increasing dependence of companies on technology, travel, and long supply chains means that an outbreak in a single country can have serious global repercussions. Analysts say that the epicenter of the crisis comes from the Chinese economy, and its effects are spreading in a very upsetting way on other economies. It's also important to keep in mind that consumption in China is slowing down in addition to production. So, as consumption decreases, it's likely that we can expect less demand for some extractive primary products, declares economist and professor Ariel Slipak. During an interview for an Argentinian journal, he stated that the stagnation of production in different parts of China will lead some supply chains to be cut. Today, China is a global supplier for the North American and German economies for high technological complexity products. Now, this implies that in the short term, if they look for alternative suppliers, the price of this type of product is likely to climb. He also says that there could be a change in relative prices that would potentially harm some countries in Latin America. Another impact that will be felt in emerging countries concerns commodity prices. Many of them rely heavily on these resources for their currencies. In general, the global drop in prices was 37% this year. In the metal sector, the contraction would be 18% against 6.8% in agriculture. Cotton will shrink by 22% against 15% in sugar and 7% in soy. The UN also estimates that exports from emerging countries should suffer, even with the rescue package from China. This will mean significantly less demand for exports to other developing economies. Losses in the volume of exports will be exacerbated by the sharp drops in the prices of energy and raw materials, which still are the main goods many developing countries export. In total, developing countries as a whole, except China, are projected to lose nearly $800 billion in terms of export earnings in 2020. Such a drastic drop in their foreign exchange earnings will add to the challenges already posed by the devaluation of their own currencies against the US dollar. Although imports may shrink by around $575 billion, the global drop in the trade balance of approximately $225 billion will still bring alarming consequences for their respective development needs, their structural transformation plans, and capacity to generate production, plus their ability to continue to face external financial transactions. Also, as maintained by the UNCTAD, other items in the current accounts, such as remittances, royalty payments and outflows, are likely to increase the financing difficulties faced by many developing countries over the next year. The economic consequences of the crash are ongoing and increasingly difficult to predict, but there are clear indications that things are going to get much worse for developing economies before they get better, says the UNCTAD Secretary General Mukhisa Kitoi. The publishing also shows that during the first 2 months since the virus started spreading beyond China, developing countries have suffered a huge blow in terms of capital outflows, increasing yield spreads, currency devaluations, and revenue loss from exports, including dropping commodity prices and declining tourist revenues. According to Celso Grisi from the Latin America FIA, if the disease control doesn't present more encouraging results in the next few months, a global recession is almost inevitable, saying, "We will have a huge demand and price decreases. That's likely to happen because it interferes directly with world mobility. It closes borders for human movement. Work will have to be reduced, mainly collective work and work in large units where there are concentrations of people. All this can bring prospects for a recession," he said. The United Nations also points out that recently developed economies in China have assembled huge government packages that, according to the G20, will guarantee $5 trillion. It also estimates that such packages will translate into a demand injunction up to $2 trillion for the main economies of G20 and a turnaround of 2% in global production. But even so, the world's economy won't escape from recession, with a forecast of global income loss in the trillions of dollars. It's estimated that a funding gap of $2 to $3 trillion will be created for developing countries over the next 2 years. The lack of monetary, fiscal, and administrative capacity to respond to this crisis will make the consequences of a combined health crisis and a global recession catastrophic for many emerging countries and will keep them away from the Sustainable Development Goals. Richard Kozel-Wright, Director of Globalization and Development Strategies at UNCTAD, has confirmed that developed economies have promised to do whatever it takes to prevent their businesses and families from suffering a severe loss of income. But for G20 leaders to maintain their commitment to a global response in the spirit of solidarity, a proportional action is going to be necessary for the 6 billion people who live outside the central economies of G20. A well-coordinated effort will be needed to develop the monetary infrastructure that will be allowing countries to manage this and future crises. The IMF and the World Bank are well-placed to play a leading role in this scenario, but they will need rich countries of the developed world to organize this action and to provide resources. And this is an enormous challenge, mainly because there is a growing nationalism in many parts of the world. China has risen as a geopolitical counterpoint for the United States, and domestic fiscal tension results in a lower disposition to become involved in the coordination of international policies. Short-term, policymakers, including the IMF, are already discussing possible measures to address this imminent problem. Some solutions have been tested in passive sovereign debt crises, while others are new ideas, such as the elaboration of an agreement for the G20 countries to offer relief in bilateral loan payments to 76 of the world's poorest countries. Other possible solutions to deal with the debt crisis in the emerging economies include governments and other supranational agencies that offer credit enhancement and loan guarantee programs for corporate borrowers, or the expansion of the IMF's flexible credit line to meet demands through crisis prevention and mitigation loans. The UN also suggests a strategy on four fronts, the first being a $1 trillion cash injection, a kind of helicopter money drop for those left behind using IMF-stipulated guidelines. The second option would be adopting measures that allow debt pardoning for economies in difficulties. Now, the UN also suggests a kind of Marshall Plan and foresees $500 billion to finance emergency health services and social assistance programs in the poorest countries. And finally, it recommends capital control to reduce the pace of capital outflows, reducing the lack of liquidity. In conclusion, it is possible to realize why the fast dissemination of the disease is how our interconnected world makes us vulnerable to risks, common not only on the health but on the economy. If policymakers in China, Europe, Japan, and the United States are aware of how damaging a collapse in the developing world would be, not only for themselves but the rest of the G20, there could be greater support for building a structure to help stabilize and rebuild the emerging economies from the economic crisis we are about to experience.